Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Permanent Damage, Memoirs of an Outrageous Girl, by Mercy Fontenot. Foreword by Lindsay Parker. Read by Natasha Soudek. Foreword by Lindsay Parker.
How are you still alive?
That was the recurring question I'd incredulously blurt out during my nearly 3 years of conversations with the mythical Miss Mercy as I attempted to capture her death and odds-defying story.
How are you still here?
I'd gasp as she shared tale after jaw-dropping tale of her fearless, sometimes reckless existence. But this was just a running joke between us. Because honestly, I thought Mercy Fontenot would live forever. I thought she'd outlive Keith Richards. Even toward the very end, I still thought this true soul survivor would outlive us all. Mercy was, of course, best known as the most outrageous and possibly least together member of the trailblazing, Frank Zappa-produced girl group, the GTOs, or Girls Together Outrageously, alongside her best friend, Pamela DeBar, author of the celebrated groupie tell-all, I'm with a Band. When Rolling Stone reported the news of Mercy's July 2020 death at age 71, her GTO's tenure pretty much comprised the entire obituary. But if there was ever a Zelig of rock and roll, it was Mercy. When the first acid test went down in the Haight-Ashbury, or when Jimi Hendrix made history at Monterey Pop, she was there. When the Stones played Altamont, she was there. Even though her tarot card reading for the band the night before had spelled disaster. When Al Green was a rising star in Memphis, or Wat Stacks took place at the Los Angeles Memorial Coliseum, or punk rock was just beginning to take over Hollywood, she was there. She later explained to me that she knew how to gravitate toward music's energy centers. It was one of her greatest talents. She really should have gone into A&R. Mercy was such a character, such a one-off, such a threat to normalcy, as Pamela had once written, that I knew she had her own story to tell. A very different story, a story much darker than Pamela's. When she finally agreed to work on her memoirs with me, after I'd been trying to convince her for ages, she suggested the title, I'm with a Band Too, which I shut down immediately. But A Threat to Normalcy almost made the cut. I knew that Mercy's stint in the GTOs would be but one of many fascinating chapters. It was January 27th, 2017, when it all began. Mercy rang me out of the blue to let me know she'd had a health scare and would soon be undergoing a serious operation. She wanted to see me, to say goodbye, just in case. She asked me to meet her at DJ Miles Tackett's Funky Soul Night on Broadway event at downtown LA's Globe Theater, where she would be serving as a dance contest judge. I have two vivid memories of that evening. One was how she cantankerously complained about the contestants' dancing skills, or lack thereof. Mercy gave absolutely zero fucks, and never had a problem speaking her mind. The other memory is our ascent up to the balcony via the Globe's faded, brocade-carpeted stairwell. Mercy was ahead of me, swathed in a ridiculously molting red feather boa, trailing loose feathers in her wake. It was almost a metaphor for the colorful chaos that ensued whenever she burst into any room. Thinking this might be the last time I'd see her, I surreptitiously scooped up a fistful of feathers and tucked them into my purse. I just wanted something to remember her by. I still have those ruby plumes, but as it turned out, there would be many memories to come. Mercy survived her surgery, just like she'd survived everything else that had been thrown at her. But while my feather-gathering moment was the first and really only occasion when I had a sense of this larger-than-life lady's mortality, it seemed to have put Mercy in a reflective mood. So, a couple weeks later, she called me again, and she called my bluff. So, are we doing this book or what? I guess we were then. I soon learned that cantankerous was Mercy's default, her forever mood, as the kids say. Getting her to open up and tell her stories honestly was way more challenging than I'd anticipated, especially considering how unfiltered she usually was. You try remembering things that happened 50 years ago when you get to be my age, she used to bark at me when I pressed too hard. There was a guard up, a certain brittleness, which I eventually realized was the result of enduring some truly harrowing experiences that would have broken or even killed a lesser woman decades earlier. She only wept once, right in the middle of some Hollywood Boulevard fast food joint while discussing her fraught relationship with her son, Lucky. But she quickly regained her composure, seemingly surprised by her momentary breakdown. "Why am I crying?" she asked aloud, nervously stabbing her fries into a plate of ketchup. I knew why. Once, when I asked her what she wanted the overall vibe or message of her autobiography to be, she shrugged and answered, "I just want it to be fun." It was my job to convince Mercy that her not-so-fun stories of abuse, addiction, recovery, and redemption were just as compelling as the wacky anecdotes about her jumping out of a cake at Alice Cooper's record release party, thrift shopping with Rod Stewart, or riding in a limo with Mick and Marianne. Don't worry, it's all in here. Mercy was tough because she had to be, but there was a sweet spirit under that fearsomely steely exterior. The dozen rhinestone belts that seemed surgically attached to her twiggy hips, and the signature Theta Barra eyeliner that Rolling Stone once described as looking like it had been applied with a canoe paddle. That softness came out in how she treated me and her many much-adored friends, and in her tireless evangelism of the music she worshipped, from Bobby Womack, David Porter, Esther Phillips, and Graham Parsons to her most recent obsessions, Starcrawler, who put her on the cover of their She Gets Around single, anything RuPaul's Drag Race related, and especially Yoshiki from X Japan, who was the last rock star she really wanted to meet before she died. Her meticulously maintained Facebook wall was a virtual shrine to her favorite people, bands, movies, and TV shows. When Mercy loved something or someone, she loved with all the fierceness of the 14-year-old fangirl she once was. It's like she had a crush on the world. She never lost her passion. She once theorized that she had cheated death so many times because she needed to complete her mission, which was to share some important music history with the world. That's in this book, too. Toward the end of our time working together, I asked Mercy what her favorite era of her life had been. She'd partied with Parsons in Laurel Canyon and in Hawaii with Hendrix. She'd appeared on two covers of Rolling Stone. She'd watched luminaries of the R&B scene in literally her own backyard while living in her father-in-law Johnny Otis's famous family home. She'd spent the 70s hanging out at The Mask and on the Soul Train set. But she simply cocked her head and said, I guess my favorite era is right now. Mercy lived every day like it was her last, until it was her last. Mercy signed her book deal only 8 days before she died after a long illness, the severity of which she hid from me, just like she maddeningly tried to hide so many things from me, minimizing her trauma, until I finally got her to open up. I was in denial, hoping she'd live to see permanent damage come out so she could bask in all the glory of bookstore signings and press interviews and roundtables, like the rock star she was always meant to be. I never intended this to be her last will and testament. I realize now, however, that that was Mercy's intention. I think once she knew her tale would be told, that she'd achieved permanence, so to speak. She felt she could finally return to whichever planet she believed was her true home. I'm going to miss my red-feathered friend. This is her story. Prologue. This could be the last time. The first time I experienced being in the news, the first time my photo was in the paper, my first taste of fame, my first connection with God, it all occurred when I was 9 years old. And it was my first, and certainly not my last, brush with death. I was vacationing with my family at the beach in sunny Sarasota, Florida, when my mother and older sister suddenly noticed I'd gone missing. I think she's dying out there, my sister announced warily, standing on the sand and pointing out to sea. I had paddled out on my boogie board way too far and found myself caught in the riptide, drifting farther and farther out, until I was just a tiny, distant dot on the horizon. My mother was shrieking, "Save my daughter! Somebody save her!" But the lifeguards couldn't get to me. No one could. I thrashed and splashed, struggling to swim back to shore, but the waves were just too rough. My little limbs soon became fatigued, my little lungs filled with salt water. I was only 9, and there I was, already assuming that this was it. This was the end for me. But then I stared up at the sky, and I prayed. Actually, it was more like I posed some sort of challenge or dare. God, if you exist, please let me live. I remember thinking very strongly, if there is a God, I will live. If there isn't, oh well, I guess I will die. But somehow I did believe that some sort of supreme being or guardian angel would hear me. Then the boat came. Over on the crest of one of those rocky waves sailed a banged-up old barge that looked just like Noah's Ark, and its captain was this silver-bearded, craggy-faced, elderly man that resembled Jesus or Moses or some sort of prophet. He intoned, "Come up and get on my boat," his booming voice sounding like it came straight out of the fucking Ten Commandments. I scrambled aboard, and then a helicopter descended and airlifted me back to my hysterically screeching mother on the beach. The next morning in the local newspaper, there was an article about a little girl that had almost drowned, but a mythical mystery man, who had apparently disappeared many years earlier and hadn't been seen since, showed up out of nowhere to save this girl's life. Then the man had vanished again. I think I saw Moses that day. I really do. And I've believed in God ever since. I made a promise to God right then and there that I would try to lead a good and noble life. I honestly don't know how great a job I did keeping that promise. I've endured things that should have killed anybody. I've ingested every drug imaginable. I've had guns pointed at my head, needles poked in my arms. I've lived on the streets. I've gambled away much of whatever nest egg I once had. I've been raped. I've had my skull bashed in enough times to shave dozens of points off my once high IQ. And I've battled cancer more than once. I've lived in the world of fear and loathing in Las Vegas, and the world of Requiem for a Dream. I think I played all 3 real-life roles in that latter movie. And yet, maybe because of my childhood vow, I never thought I would die young and leave a good-looking corpse That whole cliche of the 27 Club, or I didn't think I would make it to 30, or whatever. Occasionally now, I look back and think, how the hell am I still alive? I most definitely suffer from survivor's guilt, as I have been tested many times. I don't question or dwell on it too much, except when I look in the mirror and see all my wrinkles. But besides that, I thank the Lord for letting me be here this long so I can complete my mission, which is to share some important music history with the world. My only explanation is it's simply my destiny to be here. I've always said that fate is fate. I don't even think, really, that the Moses man saving me at sea was an act of divine intervention. I honestly believe that everything is designated, as if one's life's book is pre-written. It took an extremely long time to write my version of that book, however, since for most of my life I was so damn high that my memories tend to blur together. And there are some traumatic episodes that I've probably suppressed in order to avoid having a total breakdown. But hey, if that coping mechanism works, it works, right? So, I can't claim to have gotten every date, name, and Wikipedia-esque detail right here. But do I really wish that I'd been sober enough to remember everything more clearly? No, not really. What would I remember? That someone dropped their drumstick? That some dude played a guitar left-handed? So fucking what? All that matters is I remember the vibe. 1. You're lost, little girl. I was born on a date I will not print here, under a name I no longer answer to. Details like that haven't mattered in decades anyway. When I changed my name at age 15, taking it from Don Covey's song Mercy Mercy, I was trying to escape into another person. When people call me by my real name, I don't even want to hear it, let alone print it. It reminds me of my parents. Who knows? Maybe they weren't even my real parents. My blood type is Rh negative, and this may sound insane, but there's a theory that if you're Rh negative, then you're actually part alien. That would certainly make a lot of sense. It would, for instance, explain why I'm not as emotional as normal human beings. I do know for sure that I am not normal. Regardless, I think I was born without a fear mechanism. There's a funny photo of me from when I was a little tot, maybe age 4, sitting on the lap of some Easter bunny at the mall. He is a creepy-looking, man-sized rabbit, like a mangy monster out of some Alice in Wonderland bad acid trip, and most kids would probably be petrified, crying and trying to wriggle away from this googly-eyed crazy creature in a cheap matted fur suit. But in my photograph, I'm looking straight into the rabbit's dead-looking bug eyes, laughing defiantly. There's no anxiety, no shyness. If anything, the bunny man looks scared of me. My entire childhood was spent bouncing around from city to city. Dallas, Houston, Oklahoma City, Sarasota, Denver, Seattle, so that my father could live near a racetrack, and so he could outrun his debt collectors. My father was always getting into debt and into trouble. He used to joke that his enemies wanted to put cement shoes on him, but he probably wasn't joking, so we never stayed put for very long. Dad made his living as a car salesman. Or tried to, but he was hopelessly addicted to gambling and the high life. So maybe the addiction thing was in my blood, alien or otherwise. It took years for me to realize how much my father and I were alike. I wasn't very close with my dad. Nobody could be close with him. But he was a flamboyant character, larger than life, exceedingly charismatic, a strapping, handsome fellow who dressed like Johnny Cash in cowboy hats and snazzy suits, a real charmer. I did look up to him, and I kind of had a crush on him. He was a bit of a rock star himself, or I would actually describe him as a groupie. He was obsessed with TV and celebrities. Sometimes he made me sign fake autographs for him. I don't know what he did with them, if he sold them or kept them for himself to try to impress people. His chief obsession was Anne Margaret, who he claimed was his friend. I know he met her at least once because he did have a dog-eared, faded photo with her that he carried in his wallet and was one of his prized possessions. But he told me some tall tale about how Anne Margaret owned Marilyn Monroe's secret diaries and had tried to commit suicide, but then he found Anne and saved her. I am fairly sure he made that story up, though maybe he believed it in his pill-addled brain. In an odd way, I was Daddy's favorite. He was a wannabe social climber, and for me, he envisioned a debutante sort of life. He wanted me to mingle with socialites at the country club. You can see how that plan worked out. He wanted to be one of the beautiful people, in with the in crowd. He had big dreams. Still, I don't have too many fond memories of my father. My most vivid childhood memory of him was when he brought a top Vogue model home, with my mother there, and while he and my mom were still married. The model, Janet, was a dazzling redhead, and I am pretty sure she was the one that got my dad hooked on amphetamines. She and my father whisked me off for a joyride that night, leaving my mom in the house alone. Later, after my father dropped me off, I ended up at a bar with my mother. She was freaked out, drinking heavily, and deeply depressed. Another time, when I was about 8, my dad took off with me at Christmas and drove down to L.A. to see my favorite uncle, the film editor Warren Lowe. He didn't tell my mother. We almost drove off a cliff because he was so drunk. I woke up afterward and we were okay, but the authorities had to come pull us out of the wreckage. I guess that was my first brush with death, even before the near-drowning incident. I have no idea why my dad wasn't criminally charged, but my mother didn't even know we were gone. In the early days, my mother was fashionable and extremely beautiful. She would wear tailored two-piece suits, nipped in at the waist, and her shoes were really important to her. Her short-cropped hair was always neat and sprayed into a smooth, topographic shape, and her makeup was always impeccable. She was so polished and put together, very much the opposite of the ragtag ragdoll her freaky daughter would become. My God, she was gorgeous back then. My mom worked long hours as a registered nurse, which was unusual. It wasn't that common back then for a wife and mother to hold down a full-time, steady job. But she had to, because my father was always gambling and running around with his side chicks. Somebody had to bring home the bacon after all. And Mom's job also let her bring home a lot of pills. Sleeping pills, diet pills, tranquilizers, uppers, downers. Thanks to my mother, our house looked like a pharmacy. My mom took pills all the time, but this was normal in the 50s and early 60s. Every housewife took that stuff, along with their martinis. They popped pills during their bridge games. As for me, the first time I tried diet pills, I was about 14. I was heavy, so my mom took me to the doctor and got me a prescription. Yep, it was as simple as that. My dad and I started to take diet pills together. My mom was a bit more controlled about it, on a regimen, because she had to go to a regular job. But my father was literally necking handfuls. Soon I was as well, and the pills started to change me. I think they broadened my horizons in good ways and bad. I was pudgy as a kid. I had a lot of body issues growing up and was totally insecure about my weight. I started putting on weight around age 8 or 9 because I ate everything in the house. I ate and ate and ate. My big party trick to impress people was to eat a stick of butter whole. Probably the most shocking thing a girl can do with butter this side of Last Tango in Paris. Maybe food was my first addiction. The first of many. My God, I hated being fat. Everybody wanted to be skinny. I was just probably very shapely, now that I look back, but I considered myself obese. I tried these appetite suppressant chocolates that were supposed to make me skinnier. I don't know what they were, but I know they didn't work. But then I did a lot of speed, and I got thin really quick. I was skinny by the age of 19. No more butter deep throating for me. Nowadays, I won't even put cream or full-fat milk in my coffee. Oddly, I never drank alcohol. Booze was one thing that didn't tempt me. My father was a terrible alcoholic, and I had decided never, ever to be like him. So I made sure that I got very sick at the age of 12 by guzzling cream de menthe until I upchucked all over the place. My own sort of amateur aversion therapy. And it worked. I rarely drank after that, maybe 2 or 3 times, and when I did, I would instantly feel nauseous and have to stop. Of course, when I was 12, I had no idea that my dad was also a speed freak. Had I known, maybe I would have never gotten on speed either. My mom was a fanatic for rock and roll music, all the great rockabilly stuff, Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Sun Records. She was a groupie in her own way, but she didn't chase after anybody. Later, when I was older, I think she was thrilled, at least at first, that I was hanging out with all these rock stars. She lived vicariously through my adventures. I even took my mom to see Janis Joplin once, and she dug it. I, on the other hand, ran out of there screaming in terror because I was on acid, and Janis's voice was too intensely witchy for my state of mind. I once had Tiny Tim ring my mother on the phone when he was loaded at a party after drinking all the beers of the world in his refrigerator. He was drunk and rolling on the floor, but she was still excited when he called. But eventually I became so messed up that my mom became unimpressed with my rock and roll lifestyle. Growing up, we didn't have a real home. My sister, Sandra, who was 5 years older, hated me when we were kids. I think she was jealous that my father paid much more attention to me because I was the young and cute one, believe it or not. I remember one time when Sandra was bouncing on my pogo stick and I wanted it back. My father, who was plastered, knocked her off it, right to the ground. My sister always despised my dad for doing that, and because she thought he had drowned our pet cats. Then, on my mother's deathbed, my mom told Sandra that she was the one that had killed the kitties. My mother thought the cats had rabies and needed to be put down. My family was nuts, basically. My sister got married at 15 just to get the heck out of there, and she ended up in and out of mental institutions for a while, though we became close in our later years. My early childhood was not integrated. In every city we temporarily called home, the blacks all lived on the other side of the tracks. The Mexicans only hung out with Mexicans, the Italians with other Italians, etc. Music was the one great integrating force in my life. Chuck Berry was the first rock and roller I saw in Ed Sullivan, but the first black artist I heard that truly affected me was Lightnin' Hopkins. I thought, wow, I really like that. That's cool. It was as simple as that. I started getting way into black music from then on, along with soulful white artists like Dusty Springfield, Eric Burdon, and Van Morrison. I always gravitated toward black music, although back then it was called race music. Record stores used to keep it in paper bags underneath the counter. There were certain black radio stations that were knocking down the doors and playing black musicians, and as I bounced all over the country, I picked up all the roots music and black channels, including XERB, a Mexican border radio station with a young DJ named Wolfman Jack. I was listening to everything from country and western all the way to the blues, and it completely expanded my mind. That's why I have a roots music obsession to this day, because I had no roots myself. Moving around all the time was admittedly hard on me. I was a loud, attention-starved kid. I still am, I suppose. In elementary school, they wanted to put me in speech classes to soften me up, though that obviously didn't work. And my mother used to beat me with a razor strap, which is what they used back then to punish incorrigible children. That obviously didn't work either. But wherever I went, I always made friends. In the eighth grade, I even ran for student body treasurer and lost by only one vote. I did win a school twist dance contest that same year, which, of course, was more important to me. But eventually, when I was about 14, my family settled in the Northern California suburb of San Mateo, in the hillside garden apartments due to their convenient proximity to the Bay Meadows racetrack. It was there that I met two very important friends, Monty Moore and Ricky Prescott, who truly sent me on my path. Or maybe we were already going down the same path, and it was our destiny to travel it together. There were four of us, a girl named Linda being the other one, and Linda had a cousin that was supposedly working for all the British invasion bands. And supposedly, those bands were writing us letters. Every week, we'd receive a big packet full of mail from the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, and the Animals, and we would excitedly answer back on our girly, scented pink stationery. The letters came postmarked from England and seemed legitimate, though to this day I don't know who was really writing them. Maybe it was all a scam. But through that, Ricky, Monty, and I forged a connection. And I quickly morphed into Ricky Lake's character in Hairspray, obsessed with all things music, with Mom's uppers racing through my teenage bloodstream and only intensifying the radio waves that called me through Wolfman Jack, Tom Donahue, XERB, and KSOL. In 1965, the girls and I went to this hotel where we'd heard the Beatles were staying. We got a room, checked in, and I slept in the bathtub. We never met the Beatles that day, and we didn't even really try. We just wanted to be close to them. That same year, we went to Sacramento's Memorial Auditorium to go see the Stones, who were playing with Patti LaBelle and the Bluebells. Keith Richards got electrocuted on stage. The curtain fell down, and the whole concert came to a crashing halt. We hopped in the car and followed the Stones to see if Keith was all right. We didn't realize he wasn't in the car. The Stones had switched cars to fool crazy fans like us, and Keith had been taken to the hospital on his own. Still, we trailed the band all the way back to their little bungalow hotel in Sacramento, and this time we got much closer to our idols. Early on, I was atomically attracted to the Fame frequency. My earliest rock and roll memory is meeting the Ink Spots at age 7 and asking them for their autograph. I was at a bowling alley with my dad and spotted them. After that, I dreamed of meeting the Beau Brummels, and I willed it into reality. I was in a restaurant with my mother, and there they were, the Beau Brummels, eating dinner next to us. I dreamed up everyone I wanted to meet, and I had long dreamed of meeting Brian Jones. So that night, after the Stones' ill-fated show in Sacramento, we ended up in Brian's hotel room. He had his door open, so we simply walked right in, and he let us. I guess we seemed harmless enough to him. He was a sweetheart. I just sat there in silent awe and watched him rummaging through his suitcase and all his exquisite rock and roll clothes. I loved Brian with all my heart, but I didn't know anything about sex or anything. I was too young to care about wanting to sleep with him. I was content just to look at him and be in his presence. I would become friends with Mick Jagger and Keith Richards in a few years' time, but tragically, Brian is someone I never really got to know. However, I was actually wearing Brian Jones's coat, lent to me by my boyfriend, Jobraeth, when I found out Brian had died in 1969. I was devastated by the news. I had been writing my diaries to Brian for years. Monty Moore was a real trip. She was fabulous. She was a beatnik, a rich chick, and both of her parents, who were never around, were morphine addicts. I used to call her the morphine orphan. She had keen painting eyes and dressed like a little elf, with a cape and pointy shoes and waist-length, stick-straight hair perfectly parted down the middle. She smoked pot all day in her basement and listened to Gil Evans and Django Reinhardt and all the jazz cats. I had a massive dopey crush on her. Monty was the one that took me to North Beach, which was a whole other scene before the hippies took over. The beatniks were anti-everything, and I loved that. They listened to folk singers, played chess, wrote poetry, and were brooding and mysterious and sophisticated and hip. I loved North Beach, with soul music and jazz and folk and Chicago blues blasting out of all the record shops, along with Bob Dylan moaning his words of wisdom. Monty introduced me to that entire magical world, whisking me off to the Blue Unicorn, the cool folk hangout in San Francisco. The Blue Unicorn is where I grabbed the first boy I went to bed with when I was 15, Frank. At least I think his name was Frank. He could have been anybody, really. He could have been Jack Kerouac, for all I know. He was a hunky, motorcycle-driving beatnik, light-haired and more manly than I usually went for, probably about 25 years old. I can't claim that our one-night stand was romantic or earth-shattering or anything like that. We just clambered up to the Blue Unicorn's cavernous attic, piled with beds, mattresses laid out end to end on the floor, and had sex. It was nothing to me. I merely wanted to experience it and get it over with. I remember thinking, wow, this hurts. Is that all there is? But then I figured, well, at least I did it. Frank was a nice guy, though. It wasn't like he knocked me down on a bed or made me do anything I didn't want to do. And afterward, he even gave me a ride home on his motorbike. Sex to me was boring. It wasn't until I was in my late 20s that I finally found out it could be incredible. Monty took me to the Longshoremen's Union Hall's famous first acid test festival, organized by counterculture author Ken Kesey, in January 1966, to celebrate all the glories of this newfangled drug called LSD. I don't recall very much about it. I remember Allen Ginsberg babbling zany stuff and ringing his bells and cymbals with his fingers, ding, 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 while I was dancing. All I remember is that and the light show. I think someone dropped something in my drink because at all these far-out hangouts, the beatniks and hippies were spiking everything. I hadn't tried LSD myself yet, but a couple weeks later, Monty would change all that. One night, Monty and I were taking a car ride back from North Beach, and she gave me a tablet. She said, "Take this." And I did, because I idolized her and would have done anything she told me to do. A few minutes later, she yelled, "You have lemons in your mouth!" She put that notion in my head, and I just couldn't shake it. She was right. I could feel the pulp, taste the sour sting of the juice. My vision then started to pixelate and blur into tracers. Then Monty unceremoniously dropped me off at my house, and I was left alone in my bedroom. I collapsed on my frilly twin bed, trembling, staring at my many gypsy bracelets metamorphosing into snakes and slithering up my chubby arms. The walls started breathing. My parents' whispers down the hallway were echoing, making my bedroom walls vibrate and undulate with their every word. I glanced out my window and I saw a carnival downstairs on the driveway, complete with a Ferris wheel, clowns on stilts, sideshow acts, fireworks, and a raging funhouse. Then I dove inside my transistor radio, which I suppose, in retrospect, was a metaphor for my life. I went inside my little portable radio and wandered around. There were bands inside. Every time a song would play, that band would be in the radio, standing right in front of me. That part was fabulous. The rest was terrifying. I thought I was losing my damn mind. I was scared senseless because nobody knew much about LSD yet, so I had absolutely no idea what was happening to me. The next day, still spooked, I went outside to walk it off, and the sidewalks were shifting beneath my feet. I went over to my girlfriend Beverly's house and I told her, "Never take LSD." Of course, I would soon go on to ignore my own advice and drop acid all the time. As petrified as I'd been by this trip, I was ultimately lured in by the unknown. Just like my body after the attic encounter with Frank the Beatnik, my mind was no longer a virgin. Nothing would ever be the same. Besides, I'd soon be living in Haight-Ashbury. And in the Haight, people did acid whether they wanted to or not. That's just how it was. LSD was anywhere and everywhere and unavoidable. I left my parents' house at age 15, just like my sister Sandra before me. My mother was heartbroken. She was trying so, so hard to understand me, but I was long gone in my mind. She'd already lost her oldest daughter, and she really didn't have a husband, and now here I was going off the deep end. But I couldn't stay, especially after I came home late one night and my father tried to strangle me, claiming I was killing my mother with the reckless life I was leading. He sure was one to talk. Unlike my sister, however, who'd escaped into a child-bride marriage, I escaped to San Francisco. Ricky Prescott was a grade ahead of me, and when she moved there, I happily followed and shacked up with her. Ricky was another one of my major girl crushes, a vision in gossamer vintage dresses, her flowing hair festooned with dozens of fresh flowers. Haight-Ashbury was this mecca of Victorian houses that could be rented for practically nothing, like 15 rooms for $50 a month, and our neighbors there were incredible. I mean, we'd be in a house with Janis Joplin, literally, rehearsing downstairs. When I arrived in Haight-Ashbury, I felt like I finally had a home, there with my fellow outcasts, the Fellini people, in the freak zone. We all looked like we'd stepped out of a dream, and it was a dream. Until it became a nightmare. 2. Love and Haight. Everyone thinks the Haight-Ashbury was so glorious and glamorous, but it wasn't all peace, love, and understanding. The mob was moving in and knocking off my friends, sawing off my friends' arms because they were independent drug salesmen, stuffing people into car trunks. I had guns pulled on me all the time. It was hardly the summer of love. The summer of love was just a tourist attraction to me, something Time magazine made up. The flip side, the dark side, was always going on.
There were some amazing times, of course. The love-ins were fantastic fun, except I had to see the Grateful Dead all the time, and I was never a deadhead. But there was Blue Cheer, who were just tremendous, and at places like the Avalon and the Fillmore, you could actually see Blue Cheer on the same bill with someone like Muddy Waters or Jimi Hendrix. It was a big mixture of everything and everyone I loved. However, one of the worst drug experiences I ever had was at the Avalon Ballroom. Roki Erickson and the 13th Floor Elevators were playing the Avalon that night, and I decided to pay forward what Monty Moore had done for me and help this naive young hippie girl embark on her first acid trip. I took half of the tab myself, then gave the girl the other half. All of a sudden, my whole world started turning acid green, the color of puke. I hobbled up a long, creepy staircase in a lysergic panic, and Chet Helms, who managed Janis Joplin and worked at the Avalon, took one look at me and could tell what was up. He said, "Look, you've been poisoned. The acid out today is cut with strychnine. People are dying. But I think you'll be okay. Come with me right now. Come up to this room." Chet dragged me up the rest of the steep stairs and stuck me up there where they put all the freak-out cases. I'd never known this come-down room existed before. Chet commanded, "Just deal with it," and left me alone to chill. I could see the stage through a tiny, dirty window, and I was watching the 13th Floor Elevators play "It's All Over Now, Baby Blue" by Bob Dylan. I felt like I was dying all by myself up there. It sounded like a death song, with lyrics like, "The carpet too is moving under you," and "You must leave now. Take what you need. You think will last." I was sprawled out on the cramped room's tattered, stained carpet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.